All right, good afternoon, Detroit family. You know, I'm honored to be here today and proud to be here. I'm joined by some of our leadership with the International Executive Board, Secretary Treasurer Margaret Mock, Vice President Mike Booth, Region 1 Director LaShawn English, and Region 1D Director Laura Dickerson. And there are also many of our international staff and many of our members in the room today. I'm also honored to stand here with all of you community leaders that are the true organizers of change for humanity. Yeah, please give it up. I'm absolutely honored to join you today on a day of commemoration, celebration, and dedication to the cause of one of the greatest Americans to ever live, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. I join you as president of the United Auto Workers, a union that was born and grew up alongside Dr. King. Both the UAW and Dr. King came up during the years of the Great Depression. And while our union was founded here in Detroit, just 6 years after Dr. King's birth, many of you may not know, our first sit-down strike, it wasn't in Flint, but a month prior to the Flint strike, it was at a Fisher Body plant near Atlanta, Georgia, the home of Dr. King. When I look at these things, I can't help but see the parallels between the story of Dr. King and the story of the United Auto Workers. Throughout my walk as a union rep, I've always found a lot of inspiration from Dr. King, his teachings and his words. You know, the fact is, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. is one of the greatest labor leaders in our country's history. He wasn't president of any union, and they don't call him a labor leader in history books. But the struggle for economic and social justice on and off the job was a core part of the story of them and the vision of Dr. King. As a labor leader myself, I see King as a direct inspiration and a guiding light of the 21st century union movement. As we gather today to commemorate Dr. King's life and mission and legacy, I'm always struck by how intertwined the civil rights movement and the labor movement remain decades later. I see the echoes of Dr. King everywhere I go. Not just in our union's home, the Solidarity House, where the Reverend wrote an early draft of his I Have a Dream speech, but across the country, especially in the South, where Dr. King's voice and legacy looms large. My mind's in the South these days a lot. There are thousands of non-union auto workers concentrated in states like South Carolina, Alabama, Tennessee, and Kentucky, and thousands of these workers have launched their own movement for economic justice. In some ways, it's like nothing we've ever seen before. Tens of thousands of workers are taking action, signing union cards, launching public campaigns to win the economic justice we've just seen auto workers win at the Big Three here in Detroit and beyond. In other ways, I'd like to think Dr. King would find this movement deeply familiar. The South was Dr. King's home, and the home of both the American dreams and the American nightmares that Dr. King and many in the civil rights movement knew all too well. And our movement is now again walking down the path that Dr. King forged. Dr. King was no stranger to the fight for workers' rights. It was King who said, "All labor has dignity." Dr. King was no stranger to the strike. In fact, Dr. King's final campaign was exactly that, the Memphis sanitation workers' strike. It was King who said during that campaign, I quote this, "We've got to give ourselves to this struggle until the end. Nothing would be more tragic than to stop at this point. We've got to see it through. You may not be on the strike, but either we go up together or we go down together." Dr. King was no stranger to the UAW. At the 25th anniversary of our union's founding, Dr. King addressed nearly 6,000 UAW members at our convention at Cobo Hall here in Detroit. There he recalled to the assembled auto workers, "In the birth of your organization, as you confronted recalcitrant antagonists, you forged new weapons appropriate to your fight. Thus, in the 30s, when industrial unionism sought recognition as a form of industrial democracy, there were powerful forces which said to you the same words we as African Americans hear now. Never. You are not ready. You are really seeking to change our form of society. You are Reds. You are troublemakers. You are stirring up discontent and discord where none exist. You are interfering with our property rights. You are captives of sinister elements who would exploit you. Both of us have heard these reckless charges. Both of us know that what we have sought were simple, basic needs without which no man is a whole person. In your pursuit of these goals during the middle 30s, in part of your industry, you creatively stood up for your rights by sitting down at your machines, just as our courageous students are sitting down at lunch counters across the South, and we are proudly borrowing your techniques." End of quote. The sit-down strikes that built the UAW and the sit-ins that built the civil rights movement were not just similar in their tactics. They also shared a common principle. The fight for justice knows no limits. Economic justice cannot end at the doors of a factory or worksite. Social justice cannot end at the border of our country. One year to the day before Dr. King was assassinated, he gave his famous speech on the Vietnam War, where he said again, and I quote, "It should be incandescently clear that no one who has any concern for the integrity of life of America today can ignore the present war." He spoke to the poisoning effect war has, not just on its victims, but on its perpetrators. And as with so many writings and sayings of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, his words again echo today as if he's here in this room with us right now. Today, we find our government backing destruction of lives and villages, not in Vietnam, but in Gaza. And we hear the boosters of war claiming that real patriots support the bombing. But we know in this room that there is nothing more patriotic than the pursuit of justice, no matter where that takes us. That is why the UAW was proud to call for a ceasefire in Gaza and Israel. We must not be silent when it comes to the pursuit of peace and justice for working class people, the poor, and for all of humanity. That's a lesson we learned and continue to learn from Dr. King. It's that process of learning from one another, not following, not leading, but marching side by side, that marks the meaning of Martin Luther King Jr. Day for our union and for our movement. So I don't think it's a coincidence that our 21st century movement for Southern workers' rights has found its first home in the same state where Dr. King's fight left off, in Tennessee, where right now in Chattanooga, thousands of workers at Volkswagen have chosen to stand up to win their union, to change their lives, and to change the future of auto workers in America. And I don't think it's a coincidence that our new auto industry has migrated to Alabama, where thousands of workers are choosing to stand up at Mercedes, Hyundai, Toyota, Honda, and Mazda. That state was in many ways King's most iconic battlefield, from the Montgomery bus boycott to Selma's Bloody Sunday. It's the same domain of anti-worker politicians and those who would stoke racial division that America's 21st century auto worker must struggle on to achieve their fair share of economic and social justice. And I don't think it's a coincidence that nearly a century after Dr. King's birth and 90 years since the UAW's birth, we find that our struggles remain intertwined. As one movement goes, so goes the other. Finally, I must recognize Reverend King's historic role as a faith leader. Today in this house of worship, I feel the connection between King's faith and my own. Just as it was foundational in the civil rights movement, Scripture has guided our new labor movement. When I think of the labor movement and the civil rights movement, my favorite scripture always comes to mind, and that's Ecclesiastes 4, 9 through 12, where it states, "Two are better than one, for they have a greater return for their labor. If one of them falls down, the other can help them up. But pity the person who falls and has no one there to help them up. Also, if two lie down together, they can keep warm. But how does one keep warm alone? Though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves. A cord of three strands is not easily broken." This scripture lays out the pathway to drive out and defeat the enemy of humanity, our oppressor, which is hate and greed. You know, there's a saying, whenever something good happens, something bad is trying to stop it. Hate and greed know no bounds. The fight against hate and greed is never ending. Better yet, the fight for economic and social justice, the fight for humanity, is eternal. And there is no more of a just cause in all of the world. Ecclesiastes 4, 9 through 12, to me, is what solidarity means. It's what Dr. King was speaking of when he said, "Either we go up together or we go down together." Only when we stand up together will we rise up and realize the dream of Dr. King, not just for ourselves, but for all of humanity. This is our generation's defining moment. So let's honor the legacy of Dr. King, and let's stand up, and let's get to it. Thank you.